You're still watching Noways, and we're still discussing raising children in today's world. Abimbola Shomulu is a lawyer, educator, writer, family life advocate, and counselor. Also known as The Listener, she is a hybrid motivator with an uncommon ability to stir up positive energy through a sequence of support indoctrinations towards mental and emotional self-discovery. With the creation of the Agbajowo, Abi, that's it, series, which promotes collective responsibility. She is of the belief that if each of us can take responsibility for ourselves and families, society will thrive. She believes all hands must be on deck in raising children to be happy, healthy, successful, and functional adults of the society. Now remember, you can join this conversation, tweet at us at Plus TV Africa or at Waze Your Africa One with the hashtag Waze, or you send us an SMS or WhatsApp to 0818038466. We'll join Abimbola soon. But Nassau.
I used to be so proud of my Yoruba reading skills. I couldn't even pronounce that word. But I think it means coming together, the Owo part, but yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So I got it?
No, not quite. I'm not sure we did. Because even I can't correct you.
Okay, so
back to Tiwa and what she was saying, right? I mean, so I still have questions. And it's you know, when we say these things about, I think there are pros and cons for each parenting style that she's mentioned. And I don't know that she's saying authoritative is the right one, because that's the one that is, that's the one I
no,
was raised with.
There are two types.
Authoritative and permissive.
Authoritarian.
And permissive.
And authoritative is two different things.
Oh, they're all authoritarian and authoritative.
Yeah,
what's
so
the difference?
Authoritarian is almost like a dictator. You know, it is
okay,
my
so
way.
Authoritative is almost like being assertive. You okay,
that's
got
it.
Got it. Okay.
You know, so that's the style. So because for,
ah,
so
I
my
see.
Husband thinks I am permissive. You know,
but
we're having
you
that
would like
conversation.
To think that you're more authoritative.
No, so
then.
It's not like I am trying to be permissive. And this is where I'm
no,
coming
but
from.
No, but because I favor being permissive, but obviously within reason. So maybe this is where it falls for authoritative. So when I say that, I also want my children to feel like they can tell me anything. Because I think that it's in that not being able to tell you, that fear, that you lose everything and you lose your child. So I was raised that way. We used to call my dad Abacha. My dad is coming. You hear the horn. Everybody is like, you
scatter.
You are hiding under wherever. Like, what have you done? And a lot of parents, I think a lot of children in my time grew up like that as well, with very strict parents and all. But for me, I don't think it's the ideal way, because then I travel to England and my auntie would be saying, why are these kids so timid? Because you're afraid.
Because
they
you
shouted you down
so
many times. You speak like, how can you say that?
Yeah,
you
know? And this has, it has also found its way into schools.
Yeah.
So you see a child, right? The teacher would say something to the child and the child would question the teacher. So sorry, why is this like
this?
And the teacher goes, shut up, you're being rude.
Oh,
you
no,
know?
That's not
so,
acceptable.
You know, that's what I'm trying to say to you, that, you know, when I'm trying to have a conversation with my children, mm-hmm. my husband feels that some things...
They shouldn't even be saying, right?
No, that it should just give them
just
the instruction
them
and all of
no.
that. And I keep telling him that I want to tell them why it is
important
that they're doing this.
Very important.
You know, so if you, even if it's the house chores, you need to know why you're doing the house chores.
Very,
you
very
need to know
key.
Why it is important for you to keep your environment clean. You know, because if you do that, I feel...
Then I will do it from a place
of love. I will do it from a place
and
of ownership.
And ownership. Which you is know? Why a Nigerian can throw trash on the road and not feel any
not
type
feel
of way
any,
about
yes,
it. Because
no,
they don't understand why they shouldn't. It's
so for instance, when I see people throw trash, I cringe. You know,
people be like, what's wrong with you? They'll
that.
Say you're being bougie.
Do you understand? And it doesn't make any sense.
Doesn't,
you know,
doesn't.
So for me, I think those are the kind of questions that I would love to ask. And I think we have Abimbola. I think we'll have Abimbola down there. We'll come to Tiwalade much later. Abimbola, good evening. Thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Good evening. How are you today?
I'm very, very well. You're looking so amazing.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank
so
you
quickly, because we need to understand, you know, when we say we want to raise children of today, is it possible that we can mix the old and the new in terms of raising this generation, you know, mix what we learned and how we were raised and, you know, what is happening now? Is it possible?
Well, I think a balance can work, but not absolutely. And I'll tell you why. A few things that people have said over time, and I think it's even a quote that we can't raise our children the way we were raised, because the way we were raised, the world doesn't exist anymore. Let me give you a few examples. In our time, children were seen, not heard. You can't do that anymore. They have to be heard. In our own time, I mean, the cane was something you use. You can't do that anymore. You can just deprive them of their gadgets, which is something that they love, or deprive them of going to their friend's house or things like that. In our own time, when a child does something wrong, everybody will be part of it. The neighbor, your auntie and everything, we all talk to the children at the same time and scold the children. Even when you are being admonished, people don't even beg because they want you to be scolded. But now we're very individualistic. Everybody wants to mind their business because you're even careful what the other person will say if you tell them that this is what the child has done. So we have to change quite a lot of things about raising our children now. The way we, so now children want to feel accepted. They want to feel, they want to have your attention. They want you to show them that you care. They want affirmation. In those days, I mean, your parents say, this is it. We use, like the speaker said, we use authoritative means of saying it is my way or the highway. We can't do that anymore. We have to explain things to them. They have to have understanding of what you're explaining. So if you say, don't go to the neighbor's house, but why? Why can't I? All those questions, we have to be able to answer those questions. So raising them the way we were raised, it can't work anymore. But being supportive, being able to give them what they need as opposed to what they want, because lots of times now we give them what they want, not what they need. And we have to be able to know what it is that they actually need as opposed to want. And now again, you know, most of us, in our parents' time, we never had parent conferences or reading books on parenting. You learn on the job. Now you have to ask questions. You have to read. You have to go for parent. I can imagine telling my mom that, I mean, if my mom had to go to a parenting conference and things like that. But now it's not something that we should take for granted. We have to listen.
Let me cut in there quickly. And I like what you've just said about we now read. And one of the questions I had is, in today's world, is parenting something that has to be learned as a skill? And, you know, are we now considering maybe having some sort of school where you learn how to be a better parent? Is this something that should be considered, or do we just leave it to what we've learned growing up and just find our way as we go? What are your views on this?
They are existing already. There's even some, one or two we're working on at the moment. There's some existing already.
So in Nigeria?
It has to be done. Yes, in Nigeria. You know, it has to be done. I think Praise for Forward has one school of parenting or things like that. In some churches, they have it. If a few of us are trying to start something like that, because, you know, the thing about it, our children, they cook on the internet. They cook, they learn how to do their makeup and everything. They learn how to do so many things through the internet. Do you understand? So we parents have to school ourselves. Parenting is not a joke. It's something that everything you want to do now, you want to learn about financing, you want to learn about using the computer, you go to YouTube or you go and do some training, online training and things like that. Why not parenting? Why not parenting? It has to be part of what we need to do. Do you understand? It has to be part of, even in schools, I think there should be some things that we can imbibe in schools about some things that parents, you know, a curriculum or something that it's part of what the children should expect from their parents. Do you understand? Because there's so many things that have happened in the past 10, 15 years, 20 years, that we know that we don't have answers. We're confused as parents. We don't know what to do. So professionals have to come in. People that over time they've been parents or they've learned, they've schooled themselves. They can help people, guide people in the way to be good parents. So it's very important. It has to be part of our life. It has to be part of what we need to do. Okay, so it's very essential.
I would like to ask Tiwalade, if you're back, can you hear me? There's a question. Kike is saying, I think we're losing our firmness with kids. We need discipline and communication. You know, because you were trying to explain authoritarian, permissive, authoritative, right? So somebody is thinking when you are becoming maybe authoritative, you're losing that firmness. Is that correct?
Permissive, you mean?
No, not at all. In fact, that is what we need. We need to be involved. We need to be firm. But at the same time, we need to be involved. We need to be considerate. We need to allow them, our children, to be part of our decision making. You know, for example, when you're coming up with rules, you know, you could ask them, okay, if I break this rule, if I don't tidy my room, if I don't do my homework, you know, what should be done to me? What do you think we should do if you don't tidy your room? What do you think, you know, you should get?
So
what should be the consequence,
you
know, if you don't do your homework? So they know that there are boundaries. They know that there are consequences. Do you understand?
Yeah.
But you have carried them along and they like that. So it's not that you're being permissive. You just allow them to do anything, you know, you want them to do, that they want to do.
Okay.
And so you're not being authoritarian in the sense that you don't care. All you do is give rules.
It's my way or the highway. Okay, so yes. Susan says, I recently came back home and met my kids watching TV. It took me back to my days and how we escape when we hear just the horn of our car, our father. Then John says, I miss community educating a child. And Alex is saying, I'm concerned about building an assertive and intuitive child. You know, that's from Alex. I think you should respond to Alex's comment. Then I would come to Abimbola.
Okay. He's concerned about raising an assertive child.
An intuitive child, yes.
That means he sees that a negative?
No, he's saying that how can he raise, right?
I think so.
An assertive and an intuitive child.
Oh, yeah. That's it. It's by being authoritative. It's by being, you know, you have to involve the kids.
Okay.
Like I told you, children are products of the environment, you know. If they're hiding anything from you, there's so much going on the outside. There's so much their classmates are discussing, okay. You know, that you're not going to be privileged to know about, okay, if they don't share with you. So don't think that you're the only one, you know, influencing your child. Some children take games, some children take magazines, some children take all sorts of things to school. You don't know what they do at break time, you know. So you have to make sure you are the authority figure in the home. You're the first authority figure that a child looks up to. So if the first and the primary authority figure is welcoming, you know, encourages that assertiveness in a child, the child will be able to face anybody out there. But when you shut your children down, when you don't allow them to express themselves, you know, that is where the problem comes from. So you are the primary example. You are the best person. You are the best role model for your child, you know, to be assertive. Let them ask you questions. Don't say things like, that's a stupid question. How can you say that? Come on, go. You know, the way African parents, you know, do. You know, you must be open. You must entertain their questions. You must even invite the questions. Sometimes I want to sit with myself, oh, what are you doing? Tell me what happened in school today. What do you think about, you know, you want to, you know, initiate the conversation. You want to get into their world, you know. If they are not talking, get into their world intentionally, you know. You ask them questions, let them speak out. Because
right.
If they're going to speak out and they're going to be comfortable with you, there's a higher percentage, you know, that they'll be able to do that, you know, when they're with people outside.
Outside, all right. So I'll come to Abimbola. This is a viewer from London, that's Ade. He says, good evening. How do you raise a child brought up in a negative world like Ajegunle? No access to social media or electronic gadgets. This is a location in an urban center of Lagos. I don't totally agree with Ade that Ajegunle don't have social media, but let me hear from Abimbola. Abimbola, did you hear the question?
What exactly is the question?
So he's saying that how do you raise a child brought up in a negative world like Ajegunle, where there's no access to social media or electronic gadgets? This is a location in the urban center of Lagos. I don't think Ajegunle does not have social media, but let us
imagine a world where there's no social media.
You know, the interesting thing is that as parents, we make a lot of assumptions.
Yes.
You know, you'll be amazed what the children know, what they have access to, how inquisitive and intuitive they are, how adventurous they are. The fact that a child is in Ajegunle doesn't mean the child doesn't have access to so much information.
Absolutely.
Doesn't mean the child is not well informed. The only way, even the training, you never know. The people living in Ajibunle, maybe the parents are people that even care for that child. Do you understand me? So we can't make assumptions. Ajibunle is a big place, and a lot of things have risen from Ajibunle. Do you understand? So it's not the area. It's not the environment. Some children are living in Banana Island. They have access to what's it called, internet and everything, but they're not well informed. They're not intuitive. They're not knowledgeable about so many things. So the most important thing is the information that is given to the child, and the care, the love, the attention, the exposure. Those are the things that actually the child needs. So the internet, which I know that there's internet in most places now. Even the other day, what I was trying to, when my Wi-Fi went off, my daughter connected her Wi-Fi to my phone. And I think the person doesn't have enough information as far what the children are into and what they're up to and what they have access to.
I think Ade's question is just trying to imagine a world where a child doesn't have access to that sort of information.
Well, that world doesn't exist anymore. But, well, you know, there's a question. There's a question on fathers saying one thing. And I think we'll you will start with the question, Abimbola, and Tiwalade will also respond because we're running out of time. You know, the father will say one thing and the mother will say another thing. Right? There's conflict. There's no synergy between...
No congruence.
Yeah, synergy between the father and the mother. How would that play out in the life of the child?
It's very counterproductive. And as adults, somebody has to do something about it. Somebody, between the husband or the wife, they have to have an agreement. They have to sit together and... talk about this situation, because it's going to affect the child. Children are so smart. So if the child goes to mom and mom says yes, the child will never go back to dad. But if the dad says no, the child will go back to mom and ask, and mom will say yes. So there has to be synergy. They have to come together in agreement for the good of the upbringing of the children. They just have to act like adults. Do you understand me? Because that umbrella has to be to unity in bringing up the children, because the child will be confused. The child will play on them. Do you understand? And at the end of the day, it is the child that it will be affected. So they have to act like adults. They have to speak together and in one accord that, look, even if we are going to disagree, not in front of the children, let's do this thing together so that the children will have one voice as parents. They will hear from us, and that is what I would suggest. So both of them have to communicate and do something about it. If not, it will turn out negative to impact the child negatively.
All right, so quickly to Alade. That question, and I just want to add a little bit, because yesterday we talked about millennials and societal pressure. Emotional intelligence, you understand? How do we, because we're seeing that this new world that we are going, the children have to be highly... You know, they have to, their emotional intelligence quotient has to be very high. You know, so add to that, you know, to the question of conflict between parents and emotional intelligence.
Okay, thank you so much. You know, in fact, that was a research I worked on, the influence of emotional violence on children. You see, a child is made to look up to the primary caregivers. And in this case, we're talking about parents, because parents are the primary caregivers, you know, because children grow up with what we call a schemata. It's like having like a structure. It's like having something like a house where you have already set, this is where the sitting room is, this is where the bedroom is, you know. So when that schemata is messed up, it's like, say, okay, now the bedroom is no longer upstairs. It's now in the kitchen. You bring confusion into their lives. You know, and that is what parents need to understand. When things are not consistent, you're going to bring confusion. And we're talking about raising secure children that are secure. You want them to have strong values. But when this works today, this doesn't work tomorrow, your children are going to be insecure, you know. So, and then, of course, we're talking about emotional intelligence, which we need today even more than, you know, IQ. We need that EQ more than IQ. Why? Because children can be smart academically and then be poor when it comes to, you know, how to handle their emotions. They're not able to get along with people. They can solve problems, but they can't progress. They can't burn, you know, they can't serve. They can't survive, you know, in groups. So it's very, very important. Of course, we know that. But the problem is that what if a parent, because this is a reality, sometimes parents are not able to come together and have that agreement. They should. That is the standard. That is what is right. But there are times that they will not do that, you know. So to either any of the parent that is, you know, at least aware, you know, can be a standard for the child, because that child needs that schema to be in place. You must be able to own up your mistakes. Very, very important. You must tell your child that you're wrong for what is going on. You must do that to help that child know that, okay, yeah, a bedroom is supposed to be up. That is not supposed to, you know, because you confuse the child. But if you let that child know that I did wrong, you're letting that child know that, yes, indeed, you're right. You know, the way you're thinking is right, you know. So we need to be examples. If we are falling short, we need to own up, you know, and let our children know that that is not the way to behave. I got angry. I shouldn't have. You know, sometimes I tell my son, I say, you know, sometimes you and your friends, sometimes you don't agree on something. That doesn't mean you hate the person. That doesn't mean you don't like the person. It just means that you're seeing things differently. So you have to carry them along, you know, particularly when you see that they are noticing, you know, these differences in the house.
Thank you so much. I think we can wrap it up there. Thank you so much, Tiwalade, for joining us. And thank you so much, Abimbola, for joining us this evening. We really had fun. We hope to do a part two soon. thank you so much. Thank you, Tiwalade.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thank you. Bye. So, Nasa, quickly, what's going through your mind? Because I saw you smiling and smiling.
To be honest with you, I hear them. And like I said, I guess go with the flow almost, but then also be aware that parenting is actually an intentional act. So I am happy to learn that there are schools, because, you know, playing, it's not easy. That's the truth. And I think people should just have the children that they can manage.
Abio, don't go and have the one that you cannot manage. All right, so please watch a repeat broadcast of this episode tomorrow at 3 p.m. It's been a very insightful conversation, and keep all the conversations going on all our social media platforms at We Show Africa or at Plus TV Africa as we continue to hear what you're saying. Now, in case you missed today's quote, here it is again. The best way to raise children in a negative world is to have a positive parent who love them unconditionally and serve as excellent role models. And like you heard Tiwalade say, that it's important for you to own up as a parent when you've made a mistake. So yes, it's very important.
Our parents never used to They were always
first in class. So we'll see you live tomorrow at 8 p.m. as we bring another great conversation to your screen. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Bye.